and a voice says, it was a car bomb. That moment every freedom fighter waits for, will they come for me today? And they'd come for me and I'd survived.
Albie has been through the grinder and he speaks what he lives.
Lying in bed recovering, I receive a note. Don't worry, Comrade Albie, we will avenge you. Avenge me? We're going to chop off the arms? We're going to blind people? Where's that going to get us? But if we get democracy in South Africa and freedom, that will be my soft vengeance.
When the bomb exploded, you waved to a friend that you saw.
Yes, a car was coming past, and I stood up. Instead of opening the door straight away, I waved to her, and then some people say that saved my life because I wasn't bending down to get into the car.
The way Albie lives his life, the lack of bitterness, Albie gives you faith in being human, in being South African, a white South African man. You look at Albie, you think, Albie is what is possible.
The average white person in South Africa lived a life of complete privilege and were raised under an understanding that they were supreme and it was their land and that Africans were there to serve them.
White and black were totally separated, not just physically, but in every other way.
My father was one of those people who had been arrested if he dared forget his passbook. He disappeared for about 6 months. And nobody knew where he was. Everybody thought he was probably killed or he had died.
Apartheid. South Africa's laws entrenched white supremacy and racial separation as official policy. Apartheid dictated where you could live, where you could work, whom you could marry. It denied the majority of South Africans the right to vote. Thousands of black men and women rose up to protest the laws that stripped them of their rights and restricted their movements. This defiance campaign was organized by the African National Congress, or ANC. Among the first to be arrested was a young lawyer from Johannesburg named Nelson Mandela.
A professional African voluntarily going to jail. This was such an important signal. They were calling for volunteers, and I said, take me, take me. And my comrade said, no, it's not for whites. But I said, we're a non-racial struggle. How can you say it's not for whites?
And Albie went in to the general post office in Cape Town, the main post office, to one of the sections which were reserved for non-whites. And he sat himself down and he refused to leave.
And I stood up and I said, my boy, Africa. And we were taken off to court. The magistrate looks at the charge sheet. He says, I see we have a 17-year-old here. He's a juvenile.
He wanted to be arrested to make the protest, and they sent him home and said, go home, tell your mother we sent you home, you're too young.
And I was the leader of the group, wanting to be the kind of the revolutionary leader, and I'm sent home to my mother.
It's not as if you wake up in the morning and say, I'm going to be brave and I'm going to speak up. I can't accept this. And whatever the consequences, I will say so.
He comes quite naturally to this notion of respect for minorities because he is a member of a minority group and a group that has throughout the ages been the object of hatred, intolerance.
The anti-Semitism of Hitler and certainly the pogroms featured a lot in the lives of my grandparents fleeing from Lithuania. A sense of the importance of resistance to injustice was deep. It was with our mother's, grandmother's milk, as it were.
Democracy activists of all races came together to form a Congress of the People and create a blueprint for a new South Africa. They knew their activism would expose them to considerable risk.
We came together to imagine freedom, to have a common program that would unite everybody. It didn't matter if you were desperately poor or wealthy or black or white or brown. You were South African, you were a human being, you were a citizen, you had rights.
10,000 meetings at least all over the country, and out of it came the Freedom Charter. A Freedom Charter which says South Africa belongs to all who live in it.
Look at the figures here. Lenin Ngoyi, possibly the most famous of the women's leaders. Bonnie Desai, fantastic orator. Uyosile Lemini, he was hanged. And I'm here. That's the greatest honor that's ever been bestowed upon me, is to be placed alongside these people who struggled so hard. Almost all of them are dead today. We carried the words and the spirit of the Freedom Charter inside ourselves. It wasn't a document to which you referred. It was a document that you carried in memory and constitutive of who we were and how we connected up with each other. And basically, the theme was South Africa belongs to all who live in it.
South Africa belongs to all who live in it, black and white. And no government can justly claim authority unless it is built on based on the will of the people.
And the point about that is, it's saying to the white minority, we're fighting your supremacy. If you accept the idea of equality, there's a place for you. Which means you don't fight to the last drop of blood.
Several hundred natives gathered peaceably to protest the pass laws. Police mounted on tanks opened fire. 69 natives were killed, 176 wounded.
Sharpeville was that tipping point moment. We'd had massacres before, but not on that scale. State of emergency, ANC banned, the Communist Party banned, the Pan-Africanist Congress banned, Congress of Democrats banned, individuals banned, newspapers banned, meetings banned, everything proscribed. So not only were people disenfranchised, they couldn't even protest.
At age 21, Albie became a lawyer and one of the few attorneys to represent people charged under the new repressive laws. A newly proclaimed law allowed police to arrest and imprison anyone at any time without cause or warrant, hold them for 90 days, and rearrest them.
The laws were getting worse, the repression was worse. I had clients who were picked up, they were being tortured. I would hear stories about what had happened to them. And I'd feel it getting closer and closer and closer. I'm about to enter my chambers and suddenly six enormous guys spring to life and I'm placed under arrest under the 90-day law. And the next thing, I'm in a prison cell. I'm locked up. So this is what it's like, alone in a concrete cube. It was far worse than I'd imagined. It's full of noise, gates slamming, people shouting. They're terrified. It's harsh noises all the time, nonstop. I invented different things to keep me sane. I'd imagine I'm running to the sea, and now I'm going to run to the sea.
I can continue to refuse to answer questions. They can keep me here for months more, even for years. Yet they surely cannot keep me forever. For the present, I must continue to organize my days so as to keep my morale as high as possible. This is the only real way out, to fight them day by day.
The jail diary of Albie Sachs gave us an insight into what thousands of people were living through in prison. Here it all was. The psychological part of it, the physical part of it, everything.
And I ran and ran and ran and ran and ran right through Cape Town, more than I'd ever run in my life, and I threw myself into the sea. I'd survived without saying a word. But inside, something was crushed. Something was crushed. You never, never get over solitary confinement.
While Albie was in jail, Nelson Mandela and other leaders of the African National Congress were brought to trial on charges of sabotage. The prosecutor called for the death penalty.
Actually, I thought I was the one who would be hanged, because to hang those great leaders could mean an uprising. I doubt if there would have been an uprising in my defense. And their hatred for me was palpable, from the judge, the prosecution, the security police, the media. I was the bad guy, because I was white. Nelson Mandela made his famous speech, ending with his famous line, his ideals for which he's prepared to die. That famous last line, George Bezos said, "You know, Nelson, you're asking to be hanged here. Maybe you should say, if needs be, you're prepared to die, and not just, I am prepared to die." It's a very quiet challenge to the judge, if needs be, my lord, if needs be.
It is an idea for which I hope to live for. But my lord, if it needs be, it is an idea for which I am prepared to die.